And good morning. And just like that, it's beginning to look a lot like Christmas. And Thanksgiving has come and Thanksgiving has gone. And we have enjoyed the week of just reckoning who God is, His gratefulness in our lives, His working in our lives. I've never been alcohol drunk, but I know what a food hangover is this morning, I'll tell you that. And we've eaten and enjoyed, and wow, what a time we have had. But we're looking forward to transitioning now and moving into the Christmas season and celebrating the wonderful birth of our Savior, God becoming man, Emmanuel, God with us. The hymn writer said, those angels that we've heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plain. Let's join them this morning and beginning singing the carols of Christmas. Stand if you would, 278, and let's rejoice in our great Savior's birth. Lift your voice now.
Angels we have heard on high, sweetly singing o'er the plains, and the mountains in reply echo back their joyous strains. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Shepherds, why this jubilee? Why your joyous strains prolong? Say what's made the tidings be, which inspire your heavenly song. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Come to Bethlehem and see Him whose birth the angels sing. Come adore on bended knee Christ the Lord, the newborn King. Gloria in excelsis Deo. Excelsis Deo. See within a manger laid Jesus, Lord of heaven and earth. Mary, Joseph, lend your aid, with us sing our Savior's birth. Excelsis Deo. Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Amen. Great singing. Let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you so much that we can gather this morning and begin to sing the song of joy in our hearts of the fact that your Son came, put on humanity, and came to be born in a manger, in a humble manger, as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, to demonstrate that, Father, He was willing to sacrifice Himself as a perfect Lamb of God, so that when He went to the cross and He shed His blood, His precious blood, so that the sins that I have committed and the whole world has committed can be redeemed and be paid for. Father, thank you for demonstrating such great love by allowing your Son to suffer so that I wouldn't. Father, it cost Him everything so that I could freely receive your gift of eternal life by simply putting my trust in Jesus Christ and the work he has done on the cross for every one of us. Lord, I pray that you would meet with us in a great way this morning. I pray that if there would be anyone here today that has not received that perfect gift of Christmas in their lives, that today would be the day of salvation. Use us, Lord, and allow us to receive it with gladness and joy in the life that we now live. For it is in Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Please turn around and greet those around you.
As you come back to your place, remain standing. I love just hearing this little chorus played. I sing praises to your name, O Lord. I give glory to your name, O Lord. Why? Because no other name above men declares to be praised other than the name of Jesus. Lift your voice now. Let it be a moment of worship as we praise the Lord.
I sing praises to your name, O Lord, praises to your name, O Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. I sing praises to your name, O Lord, praises to your name. I give glory to your name. I give glory to your name. Oh Lord, glory to your name. Oh Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. I give glory to your name. Oh Lord, glory to your name, O Lord, for your name is great and greatly to be praised. No other name but the name of Jesus. No other name but the name of the Lord. No other name but the name of Jesus is worthy of glory and worthy of honor and worthy of power and of praise. No other name, no other name but the name of Jesus. No other name but the name of the Lord. No other name but the name of Jesus is worthy of glory and worthy of honor and worthy of power and of praise. His name is exalted far above the earth. His name is high above the heavens. His name is exalted far above the earth. Give glory and honor and praise unto His name. No other name but the name of Jesus. No other name but the name of the Lord. No other name but the name of Jesus is worthy of glory and worthy of honor and worthy of power and all praise.
Amen. You may be seated. Wonderful singing as we lift our praise to the Lord. Just be glad you didn't have to do that song at 8:30. That'll stretch your vocal cords right there. Welcome to service this morning. Already had a wonderful day in the house of the Lord and looking forward to a great 11 o'clock service. And good to see our church family and friends and guests. And maybe you're visiting with us today for the very first time. And we're delighted to have you. And the pew in front of you is a connection card. We'd be glad for you to reach out, grab that card, fill it out, put it in the offering plate when it goes by. That gives us a record of your attendance, lets us know who invited you, and if you flip it around, there may be something of interest to you there. If you will check that, we'll be glad to have you. We had a young man come to church today, a high school student at Western High School, and his grandmother had just passed away a couple of weeks ago, and he was in our service. And even though we are not doing the Christmas lights this year, he was first introduced to our church through the Christmas lights. And he said, Pastor, he said, my grandmother died. And he said, I'm trying to connect with God. I just feel a need to connect with God. And two things were awesome. Number one, I'm glad that when there's people like that in the community, God sends them here. Amen. And I'm glad that when they get here, we're able to share the gospel with them. And we share the gospel with this young man. And look, hopefully next week, he'll receive the Lord. I say that to say this. If you're here today for the very first time, God has a reason for sending you here. And church family and friends, we know that the Lord is worshiped and praised in this place and delighted. Many of our church family are traveling back today into the city, so we pray for traveling mercy. Some of our college kids are going back to school, and so it's just a wonderful day. December 1st, how we got here so fast, I do not know. How many went Black Friday shopping? You were out there in the madness and the chaos. How many despise Black Friday shopping? Cyber Monday people, aren't you? Yeah, woohoo. I heard a woohoo from the choir right there. All right, that's wonderful. And well, the spirit and the joy of giving. While they're filling out the card, let me make some announcements. And it's a great day today. All right, we have a service tonight. Annually, this is the night when we do our church budget meeting. This is for our members or guests. You're welcome to come. Also tonight, prior to that, we have our evening service, and it's a baby dedication. It's not just a simple baby dedication. It's one that's going to take some time because God's done a wonderful miracle in the life of Ben and Linda Branch. He used the Hernan family for that, and we don't want to just speed through it. We want to give God the glory that is due His name. And so we're going to take the first part of the service and do a baby dedication. Then we'll be dismissed and come for, those can stay for our budget meeting. This is also the night that we will elect our deacons. And we have three new deacons that we want to add to our board. And so I'm excited to share all of that with you this evening. Ladies in ministry, you have a caroling night on Tuesday. So I hope you're ready for that and signed up. And we have people that Beverly has laid out. I guess now's as good a time to let you know that the number one lady on our list that we were going to send the ladies to go caroling to see was a lady named Beverly Lewis. If you come to Wednesday night Bible study, how many know Beverly Lewis? We pray for her all the time. She has difficulty breathing and she had an oxygen tank. And her prayer request was, I'm retaining carbon dioxide. And so we were praying for that. She had a couple of spells. And there was somebody there to help her. But on Wednesday, she had a spell. And the only person there was Jesus. And he took her home to heaven to be with him. And so our dear sister is with the Lord. And she's hearing the angels sing, which I'm sure sounds better than our ladies singing. And so she's enjoying that a little bit. And she's with her precious Savior. So we're going to move on and sing to those that are here in our shut-in list. I hope and pray, ladies, that you'll be part of that. And then next Sunday is our children's Christmas program in the evening. They've been working so hard. When you come next Sunday, the whole stage is going to be set up in a theatrical way. They've got a great story to tell for Christmas. I hope and pray that you're here for that. They don't want to sing to an empty auditorium. The service will be at 6 o'clock, and I know that you'll be blessed for being here for the children's Christmas program. All kinds of other announcements that are there, and I'll mention some of them a little bit later. The choir did a marvelous job at 8:30 introducing us to the Christmas season. They're singing a song entitled, Come, Thou Long Expected Jesus. God bless you, choir, as you lift your voice.
Come here.
Thank you, choir. I trust that he has been born in your heart, that your heart will be his throne as he's seated high upon that. You know, Christmas time is the story of Jesus. You find the hymn on page number 295, one of the great hymns written by one of the greatest hymn writers to ever write. Her name is Fanny Crosby. She wrote a wonderful hymn that tells the story of Jesus. Christmas time is not the beginning or the end of the Lord Jesus. It's just simply part of his story. And if you are a believer, if you are a student of the Word of God, if you read your Bible, you ought to be able to trace through the verses the story of the life of Jesus. She opens the hymn with the declaration that it is the story most precious, sweetest, that was ever heard. When you look at stanza 3 of verse number 1, she begins with, "Tell how the angels in chorus sang as they welcomed his birth." Verse number 2 talks about his days on the earth prior to the cross, of his labor, of his sorrow, how he was despised and afflicted, homeless, rejected, and poor. Verse number 3 tells the purpose of his birth, as he was to the cross where they nailed him, writhing in anguish and pain, tells of the grave where they laid him, but yet tell how he liveth again. I love verse number 3 in the third stanza. Love in that story so tender, clearer than ever I see. I hope the hymn will bring a clearness of the Lord Jesus to you. I hope the Christmas season will bring a clearness of the love of God as you see his hand in this time of year. Stand if you would. Let's lift our voice. Let's sing of this precious story.
Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Tell how the angels in chorus sang as they welcomed his birth. Glory to God in the highest, peace and good tidings to earth. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Fasting alone in the desert, tell of the days that are past, how for our sins he was tempted, yet was triumphant at last. Tell of the years of his labor, tell of the sorrow he bore. He was despised and afflicted, homeless, rejected, and poor. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard. Tell of the cross where they nailed him, writhing in anguish and pain. Tell of the grave where he laid him, tell how he liveth again. Love in that story so tender, clearer than ever I see. Stay, let me weep while you whisper, love paid a ransom for me. Tell me the story of Jesus, write on my heart every word. Tell me the your story most precious, sweetest that ever was heard.
Is that Stephen and Victoria over there? Raise your hand high. Welcome back home, Victoria. Thank you for bringing your husband with you. I understand we're going to have a baby in February? April. They were married in this church how many years ago? 1 year ago, last Christmas. Yeah, amen. That's wonderful. You drank out of that water fountain over there. I told you not to do that. One of the most powerful redeeming testimonies is possessed by Victoria Grider. Boy, God really redeemed her, and I'm so excited for that. And you're in our prayers. Somehow the sound is not right, and I'm preaching about the spirit and the flesh, so I'm going to practice what I preach, aren't I? And I think they got it messed up from the children's Christmas program, but Reuben will get it right within the next 5 minutes, or Reuben and Beverly Lewis are going to do a duet up there. All right. Hey, December 15th, we have our building fund offering, right? We're trying to raise money to put our parking lot in. We're trying to raise money to do these other things. I'm counting on you, church family, to have your offering ready on that and to be prepared. All right, let's have our prayer. Heavenly Father, God, what a joy, what a privilege it is to not just know the story, but to know the person behind the story. Not for it just to be something that is told, but to be someone that is possessed as the Lord Jesus lives within our hearts. And all the Christmas story, it goes thousands of years back to the creation of man, when man fell in the garden, and the promise that God, you gave to humanity, there would be a seed of a woman, and he would crush the head of the serpent and bruise his heel, and you have the gospel all in that, Calvary in that, the resurrection in that. And then you chose you a people. You started with a man named Abraham. You worked through his son. You created a nation, and the promise would come through that nation. And God, you sent prophets to declare and to preach. And then there was a time of silence. And then in the fullness of time, God sent forth his son, made of a woman. God, you allowed your son to come to earth and put on humanity, to live a sinless life and to go to the cross and pay for our sin. They took him down. 3 days he laid in that tomb. On that third day, up from the grave, he arose. And all the story goes on and goes on in our lives as Jesus is born in the hearts and lives of people. Pray for our service today. I pray you'd help me preach with power and authority. Lord, the word of God is so needed today in this one area as we lift people today. Lord, when we leave here, may we love people. Oh, may we love people and be used of God in the lives of people. Thank you for Stephen and Victoria home today and what you're doing in their life. I pray your richest blessing upon them. Protect the little baby, God. We have a baby dedication tonight. And just so great to see your hand of life. Lord, meet our need in our building program now. We trust you for that. Have your way in this service, I pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated as we continue our time of worship. Listen to this beautiful offertory. Thank you, fellas. That was great. Take your Bible, if you would, please. Find the sixth chapter of the book of Galatians. Galatians chapter 6 will be our text this morning as we continue in our series on this first Sunday of the month of December, this first day of the month of December. Our series in which we've started weeks ago entitled The Life in Which I Now Live. This title came from the book of Galatians itself, from the second chapter, verse number 20. And it is a description of this new life that the Apostle Paul has found in the Lord Jesus. This new life that the Apostle Paul has found as justified and redeemed. We call it being born again. Some call it the faith life. Some call it the Christian life. Some call it the saved life. This is a life where the Lord Jesus himself lives inside of us through his precious spirit. This is a life that is given to us as we impart and put faith upon the Lord Jesus and trust him, his death, his burial, and his resurrection. As we open up our heart and believe upon him, for him to do for us what we cannot do ourselves. And that would be the forgiveness of our sin, the cleansing from the guilt of that, and to bring to us new life. And so I've been preaching to you all about that and the description of this life, not so it would just be something we would know in our brains, but something that we would practice in our lives and apply to our Christian walk. It's fitting, and it always amazes me how the Lord times the messages. And the message today is a lifting message. It is a message today of love. It's a message of restoration. It's a message of kindness and grace and hope and being involved in the lives of people. Such a blessing it would be for the season we find ourselves as it's the Christmas season. And so I have preached to you messages about this life, and you can go and listen to them, that it's a liberated life, that it's a love life, that it's a led, L-E-D, life. And today I want to preach to you a message entitled A Lifting Life. And I would encourage you to join me with verse number 1 of chapter number 6. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are, what's that word? Spiritual. Restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest also thou be tempted. Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of Christ. For if a man think himself to be something, when he is, what's that word? Wow. He deceiveth himself. But let every man prove or examine his own work, and then he shall have rejoicing in himself alone, and not in another. This is interesting. For every man shall bear his own burden. It's imperative that you understand the context of these words from the Apostle Paul as they describe to us the Christian life. If you are a born-again believer here, there's then that moment where you've trusted Christ as your Savior, you need to understand the depth, the kindness, the gentleness, the mercy, and the grace that's behind this passage. The Apostle Paul is dealing with the effects of the flesh that are starting to show inside of this church. And I've talked to you and preached to you about the flesh as it is the sinful nature of humanity and the works of the flesh, as we talked about the led life. Remember, just for sake of review, that there was, when you and I were first born, we were born with a human sinful nature. When we were born again, we became partakers of the divine nature of the Lord Jesus. Christian people, true Christian people, saved people, we have two natures that live within us. We have the one that we were born in the image of Adam, that sinful nature. But we also have that one when we were born again, when the Spirit of God indwells us and brings to us the divine nature of God. That does not mean that we become a God or that we become like God in his own person or his abilities, but it does mean that his nature lives inside of me. So I really and truthfully have those two natures, and they compete in our lives as Christians for leadership. And if I allow the flesh to lead me, my old sinful nature, which still lives within me, understand, until you get a new body, you possess your old sinful nature. And sometimes people think, well, when I become a Christian, then I should just do right all the time. Anybody found that to be true? Don't raise your hand. Liar. Right? So sometimes people think, well, when I become a Christian, then it should just be easy for me to do right. The reason that it's not easy for you to do righteousness all the time is because even though I've crucified that old man, he's still in me. And he still has a voice and he still cries out for my allegiance and for my obedience there. Now, praise the Lord that there's a greater nature in me that can suppress that and put dominion over my flesh. But that nature is there. And until I get a new body, it's gonna be there. And that new body, for those that have passed, you know, when you die, your soul and your spirit goes to be with the Lord. We understand this. They either lay your body in front of us or they're gonna burn you and put you in a jar. I'm for laying my body in front of you. I want the church to record that I have left Beverly enough money not to put me in a jar, but put me in a box. Okay, so when that body goes into the ground or is burned or whatever and awaits the resurrection day. So if I were to die today, my soul and my spirit would go to be with the Lord. My body would be laid out. When Jesus comes back at the resurrection day, my soul and my spirit as me comes and my body is resurrected. It's resurrected a glorified body, a body that's not corrupt. It's with incorruption and it's absent as it's created and it's resurrected. It's absent of my old nature. I will be glad to get rid of this old nature. Right? So those of us that are on the earth when Jesus comes back, and we haven't died, but we know the Lord in our hearts and in the Spirit of God lives within us, Paul said that you would be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye. You're going to be, your body, you'll receive that new glorified body, and we'll be caught up to meet the Lord in the air. But this old nature is condemned, and it cannot be in heaven. That's why we will have the nature of the Lord. But while I live in this body, that old nature cries out for me sometimes to obey. It wants leadership in my life. And the Spirit of God cries out. He wants leadership in my life. And then I'm the one that decides as a believer who's going to lead me. And then whichever one that I follow, my flesh or the Spirit of God, there will be evidence of that following. So if I'm going to follow the flesh, then the works of the flesh will be manifested. Now, I've said this and I'll continue to say this. No Christian wants to live in the flesh. Those old works of our lives that we know and see, that which has evidenced our sinfulness, we're ashamed of that. The evidence that I'm a true Christian is I look back before I got saved, I'm ashamed of what I did back then. As a Christian now, if I sin against God, I'm ashamed of that sin. Christian people that are filled with God hate sin. Now, we love sinners. We get so mistreated here. And so we let society define us. We don't hate people. We love people. We love people. But we hate sin. And so I don't want that to be part of my life. And if I let the flesh lead, those are the works that are manifested. If I let the Spirit of God lead me, then the fruit of the Spirit and its nine virtues, the characteristics of that are part of my life. So Paul's got a little bit of a problem here in this church at Galatia. He's got some people that are being led of the flesh, and the works of the flesh are manifesting themselves. Now look and let me show you. Go to Galatians chapter 5, look at verse 15. And this really and truthfully is evidence that they're living in the flesh. Some of them, if you look at verse 15, he says, "But if you bite and devour one another, take heed that you be not consumed of one another." look, if you would, at the last verse of chapter 5. Let us not be desirous of vainglory, provoking one another, envying one another. So we have this phrase that we use as Christians. You may understand this, you may not. That puts me in the flesh. Okay, what does that mean? That means that there's this moment where I sense anger, where I sense hatred, where I sense envy, where I sense sedition, where I sense these types of things. And if a person is in the flesh, they're usually riled up, they're aggressive, they're not themselves, there's no peace, there's no love, there's no joy. And one of the evidences of the flesh is that it is very proud and arrogant and selfish. And so what it does is it distances everybody and says, you all are nothing and I am something. You're my problem. I can't be wrong. I'm better than you. And one of the evidences that a church is living in the flesh is that there's this comparison with other people. And so I may look at Brother Nick and he has some positive traits. He has some negative traits. I can look at his negative traits and say, well, I'm a better Christian than he is. And I'm more in tune with God and God loves me more. And I can compare myself with Malcolm and I may compare Short with Malcolm. If I compare Short with somebody, then I get angry with them and upset with them. And so this is what's happening in the church of Galatia. They're biting and they're devouring and they're attacking one another. And there's not this peace and this harmony in this unity. Let me just stop and say this. I'm glad I attend a church where there's peace, harmony, and unity. All right. So all of that is going on. And the Apostle Paul now has got to remind the church of a beautiful truth about this new life. And he begins it in chapter 6, verse number 1, with the word, say it out loud, brethren. Brethren. It's a familial word. The first time you find this word used, you'd have to go all the way back to the book of Genesis, chapter number 13. And there's two men there. They're related. One's an uncle, one is a nephew. And they're having contention. Both of them have been so successful that it's hard for them to live together. They got a little bit too big for their britches. One of them did. One of them was humble. Those two men's names were Abraham and who? Lot. And so the old man had some wisdom. And the old man comes to the nephew, and the old man says, listen, man, we should not be fighting like this. We be brethren. And when he uses that phrase, the same way the Apostle Paul is using this phrase, it's designed to bring about peace, unity, and submission here. Fellows, we shouldn't be fighting like this. We be brethren. Now, it's the same way that's true in our families, is the same way that's true in our church. Born again people are brothers and sisters in Christ. Right? So we have a church family. We are not all born of the same mother, but we are all born of the same spirit. Right? So sometimes I will refer to you as, I never call Hank Hank. Why? Because have you seen how strong Hank is? I always say, Brother Hank, Brother Malcolm, Brother Nick. Sometimes I'll say sister so-and-so. Did anybody grow up in a church where you referred to everybody as brother so-and-so, sister so-and-so, right? Why do we do that? We do that because as we are one in Christ, we are brothers and sisters in the Lord. And so Paul is reminding this church, hey, we be brethren. Now, I'm thankful for my church family. If you're thankful for your church family, say amen. Why? Look, if you would, at verse number 2. Paul says, bear ye one another's burdens. I'm glad that I have a church family to share my burdens with. I'm glad I have a church family to help me and pray for me. You do as well. I'm glad we have a church family to walk together through life with. If you are here and you do not have a church family, I think you're missing out. Sometimes people call me and they want money off the street. Not sometimes, all the time. They'll call me and they'll say, Pastor, I want money. I need money to make something. And I'll just begin to ask them. Sometimes we give it, sometimes we don't. Sometimes I'll tell them, listen, our benevolence really is within our church family, and we have so much need within our family, we meet the needs of there. Then I'll ask them, do you have a church? No. Do you have a pastor? No. Do you have a church family?
No. I say, now you can understand why these are important in our lives. And so Paul's letting us know about the blessing of a church family. And he goes on here and he says, and he teaches this, if a man be overtaken in a fault. Now, this man that he's talking about is a Christian or brother or sister. This is not an unsaved person. This is somebody inside the church. If this man be overtaken, that word overtaken is the word caught, right? It's not so much without deliberateness, because they're overtaken in a fault. This fault is some type of transgression, some type of deliberate overstepping of the divine boundaries, which means they at some point made a cognitive decision as a believer to sin against God. They made a cognitive decision in that moment to curse. By the way, cursing is a sin. No born-again Christian should curse. Pastor, they made me mad. I understand. But you read that Bible, and I can take you to where the Bible talks about this: out of the same mouth ought not come cursing and blessing. So all of us as believers know what it is to make a deliberate decision to fault or overstep divine boundary. You make a deliberate decision to look, not just this, but a... or a deliberate decision to take. If a man, Christian brother, Christian sister, be caught in a deliberate overstepping of divine boundary. Well, Pastor, I don't know what type of Christian people you're talking about, but I would never overstep God's boundaries. When we all get to heaven, right? By the way, let me just be real clear about this. You strip the leadership of the Spirit of God from a believer's life, and you let a believer be led of the flesh, and a saved person can do the most wicked thing you've ever seen in your life. I've said this over and over and over again, and I hope you get it. The longer you're a Christian, the more you should be realizing how wicked you are. Huh? The longer I'm a Christian, Pastor, the more I should be realizing how wicked I am? Right. Because the longer that I'm following the leadership of the Spirit of God, the more that my flesh is crying out, and I begin to realize who I am apart from Christ, what I'm vulnerable to apart from Christ. I don't know about you, but I need the Spirit of God to keep me on the right track. So do you. And so the Apostle Paul says, now brothers, sisters, you have a brother or sister who's fallen, and they've been overtaken in a fault. They've been biting. They've been devouring. They've been exalting for glory. Brothers, no. Keep reading. Ye, which are, say that word again, spiritual. He's not talking about, I am spiritual. He's talking about those that are walking in the Spirit of God, those that are submitted to the leadership of the Spirit of God, those that the fruit of the Spirit is magnified in their life, those that are right with God in that moment. You that are spiritual, you are to restore such a one. This word restore is beautiful. It's used of mending nets. Now we don't fish like they used to fish. We use line and bobber and everything, but they would cast the net. And if the net would get torn, they'd have to restore the net. It's also used of setting a bone. If you break a bone in your body, they restore the bone by setting the bone in back into place. So ye which are spiritual, mend or set the bone back. Mend the net back. Now listen very carefully. Restoration is always back to where we were before. And so what he's talking about here is this: be ye which are spiritual, restore. That's bringing that person back to the moral condition and walk where they were prior to their fall. Now, you and I are not God. Would we agree with that? So I don't have the ability to change a man's heart. I don't have the ability to make a man do right. But I do have the ability to see my brother or my sister who has been overtaken in a fault, and to have a love for them and a desire for them to be restored back to a place where they're walking in the Spirit of God. Restored back to a place where they were before they made that deliberate choice to go against the divine boundaries, against God's divine boundaries. God's people, Christian people, we care about how our other brothers and sisters are living their lives. Lovingly, we do care about this. We're not just an island unto ourselves. Pastor, I'm a believer and I'm in the room today. But if you really knew where I was, I'm this guy. The spiritual guy? No. No. I'm the guy that's been overtaken in a fault. I was walking in the Spirit, and I stopped doing that, and I started listening to my flesh. And now I've been walking in the flesh, and the evidence of that walk is upon me. And Pastor, I appreciate what you're preaching here, and I appreciate somebody reaching out to me and a desire for me to be back. But Pastor, how do I get out of this hole that I'm in? All right, I want you to listen very carefully, because there's only one way to get out of this hole that you're in. 1 John chapter 1, verse number 9 says this: if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. That verse was given to the believer. That verse was given to you and to I when we are overtaken in a fault and we've been caught up, we've sinned against God, God lives in our heart, the Spirit of God is convicting us. And this verse is there for us to get right with the Lord. However, there's such a misunderstanding of this. What does it mean? Where do I begin? All the way back in the book of Chronicles, 2 Chronicles chapter 7, the Bible says, God said, if my people, which are called by my name, shall humble themselves. So, Pastor, if you really knew me, and you knew where I was right now, I need help. There's no help and there's no forgiveness without confession, and there's no confession without humbleness. I call it running buck syndrome. Does anybody in this auditorium understand what Pastor means when he says rutting buck? Would you raise your hand? You were born in the north, and you like venison. Pastor, you eat those deer? Absolutely. Rutting buck. When I was a kid, deer season came right up there with Christmas. And when I could not wait to go deer hunting, when you were 14, you could go deer hunting. And I grew up in northern Michigan, man. I started hunting rabbits with dogs when I was a kid. I started hunting squirrels before I knew what I was doing. If my brother disobeyed me, I'd shoot him with a BB gun. I mean, we hunted anything and everything we could. Deer season always came during mating season for the deer. And it was very helpful for the hunter to have deer season when it was mating season. Because, you guys, it's so funny, I'm speaking to people all over the world. They have no idea what deer hunting is. Deer hunting, you have to shoot the bucks. The bucks are the ones with antlers. The ones without antlers are called does. Are you with me? Nod your head. So the bucks during mating season, they wanted them does. This is not rocket science, people. And what would happen is, before mating season, as it would begin, I would go out into the woods and I would look for a tree that had scrapes in the ground, right? So this old buck, prior to mating season, started feeling like he was interested in this, right? And things were happening to him that he couldn't quite understand. And so, like a typical man, when he doesn't understand something, he beats his head against a wall. And so the buck would take his antlers and he would scrape all over that tree, up and down that tree. And he would put his wonderful cologne on that tree and he would scrape the ground that was there and he would mark his territory. And that old buck would start getting really antsy. I mean, really antsy, deep in those forests with those cedar trees. Then all of a sudden the season would start to come. And that rutting buck would be so jumpy and his neck even swells real big and they just get this wide-eyed bushy tail. I was driving my car during mating season. One ran in front of me, hit my car, got up and run away. When I got out and looked at my car, its legs were in my grill. And so they all they want are them does. And they're not going to let an 18-wheeler stop them. They're not going to let the highway stop them. They're not going to let the vehicle stop them. They're not going to let some kid in the middle of a cornfield with a Savage 270 bolt action even stop them. All they want are them does, and they're wild up about them does. And so they know not to come out of that forest, out of them cedar trees. Why would they strut right out in the middle of that field and go after them does? Because they want them does. They know they shouldn't do it, especially them big ones. They've survived a long time. But thank you, God, sometimes those big ones come out because I put them on the wall, you know, and when we shoot them. And so they're just driven to get them does, and nothing's going to stop them. Tell me you got that picture. Pastor, is this G-rated? Yeah. That's how the flesh works. Just think about that. My flesh gets all wild up. My eyes get big. Nothing else matters. I am driven for what I got to get for that flesh. No law is going to stop me. No God's going to stop me. No friend's going to stop me. Nobody's going to stop me. And even though I know it isn't where we should be, I'm going to go get what I want. That's how the flesh works. And you're never going to be able to stop that without humility. And so if you're here today and you're caught in the flesh, the first thing you got to do is you got to humble yourself before God. You got to confess your sin and agree with God as to what he sees it as it is in your life. And then you got to present yourself for a faithful and just cleansing from the Lord. And that is how the Lord will take care of our sin and restore our fellowship to us. And if you've ever been cleansed by God, there's nothing that feels better than being spiritually clean. Amen. So Paul says, now fellas, we're brethren here. Now we got a brother, he's like that stupid deer. He's been in the flesh. He's been overtaken. Now, you and I, which are spiritual, walking with the Lord, our responsibility is to reach out and to restore him. Now, we need to do it in the spirit of meekness. That means with gentleness and with humbleness and with carefulness. You just don't rush into somebody's life and butt your spiritual nose into that. That's not what he's asking to do. There's love and there's prayer and there's concern. And then I approach somebody with where they are. I reach out to them, letting them know I love them, that God loves them, that I'm here for them, that I'm able to help them. But I'm very careful in the spirit of meekness and how I approach them. And also in the spirit of meekness, there's a consideration, considering thyself, lest also thou be what, class? Tempted. See, we have a problem inside, especially Baptist churches. Baptist churches, we are known that if somebody commits a sin, we don't really try to restore them. We just kind of try to, we vote them out of membership, or we vote them away, or we do whatever, we cast them aside. And that's not loving people. That's not reaching people. That's not being biblically correct. So as somebody is overtaken in that fault and I reach out to them with a desire of restoration in the spirit of meekness, I don't want pride to get into my life. I have to consider myself lest I would be tempted. And by the way, but by the grace of God, but by the enabling of the Spirit of God, any one of us can fall at any time. You arrogant, Bible misunderstanding person who thinks, I would never do that. My brother, my sister, you start comparing yourself with other people and arrogantly exalt yourself, you're going to fall hard. Why would you say that, Pastor? I didn't say that. The Bible said that. A haughty spirit goes before destruction and pride before a fall. Amen? So, they used to say that Baptist churches, we just eat our fallen. We just cast them aside. Paul says, we be brethren here. Look at verse number 3. For if a man think himself to be something when he is nothing, he deceiveth himself. I want you to do me a favor and we'll close. You find 2 Corinthians chapter 3. I'm going to find Romans chapter 12. Please find 2 Corinthians chapter 3. You're going to read that out loud. I'm going to read to you Romans chapter 12 out loud. 2 Corinthians 3:5 is the verse you're looking for. Romans chapter 12, verse number 3 is the verse I'm going to read to you. Paul said this to the church at Rome, for I say through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith. So we're challenged not to exalt ourselves spiritually in our mind and think more highly of ourselves than we ought, but we're to think soberly. Now you read your verse, 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verse number 5. Please, everybody together, read it out loud. 1, 2, 3. But our sufficiency is who? And the day you forget that is the day you're going down. Not to think of our sufficiency in ourselves, but our sufficiency is of God. It's that type of humble mind, it's that type of understanding that keeps me submitted to walking in the Spirit. It's that type of heart and that type of mind that enables me to love a brother that has fallen. And listen, when I see somebody fall, I hope you treat me this way. I don't ever want to fall. But if one day they come to the pulpit and they read a letter and it says, sorry to tell you that Tom can't be our pastor anymore. Pray for him. He's fallen. I would understand I can't be the pastor. And I would understand that I would need help. But you wouldn't kick me to the curb, would you? I wouldn't kick you to the curb. We've got so many people that have been hurt by churches. Watch this. I did this in first service. It was amazing. How many people are in this room right now? You have somebody in your family that was fallen in some difficulty, hurt by a church, and now they want nothing to do with church anymore in their life. Raise it high. Look at all the hands. Look at all the hands. That's not the life which we now live. The life that we now live says, I love you. I love you and you love me. And we need each other and we need the Lord. And if one of us is overtaken in a fault, the spiritual one should reach out and restore us. My friends, that's the type of body and family I want to belong to. That's the type of Bible that the outside world will see in us, and they'll want our Jesus. Think more highly of yourself than you ought. That's the work of the flesh. Our sufficiency is of God. So it's the Christmas season. Here's what I'd like you to do. God's going to bring people to your name and to your mind. When God brings somebody to your mind, reach out to them. Maybe it's a family member. Maybe it's somebody you know that used to go to church. Maybe it's somebody that has a difficulty. Reach out to them. Hey, my pastor preached a message about the spiritual ones caring for our brothers and sisters in Christ. You're my brother and sister in Christ. I'm here for you. If you need me, I'm here. I'm praying for you. We need each other. We be brethren. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, God, this is what the Apostle Paul was talking about in the life in which we now live. It's not a life where we tear people apart. It's not a life that we think more highly of ourselves than we ought to. I care about my brothers and sisters in the Lord. I care about their burdens. I care about their needs. I care about them financially. I care about them spiritually. I care about them relationally. I care about their marriages. I care about their children. I care about their jobs. I care about their extended family, the births of their babies, the good times, the bad times. Lord, I want Plantation Baptist Church to be a church family. And as our brothers and sisters, there's going to be time we're going to be overtaken in a fault. But that's the time for the spiritual ones to reach out, to restore in the spirit of meekness, considering ourselves, but by the grace of God, we could be where they are, but there to walk alongside, to bear one another's burdens. So many people are hurt by Christian people. They're hurt by churches. And then that gets attributed to the person of Christ. Christ would never hurt them. He died for them. And the devil just uses that. Lord, it's the Christmas season. We're thinking about giving. May we also think about this thought of restoration for our brothers and sisters. Lord, protect our church family that we would walk in the Spirit of God. With heads bowed and eyes closed. It's one of three people in this room. Saved and unsaved, spiritual, or needing restoration. Let me start with the ones that are fallen. You've been overtaken in a fault. You know it. God knows it. You're living after the flesh. You're like that rutting buck. Pastor, I'm confronted today. I know I need to be forgiven. I know I'm not right. I know I need to humble myself. Then I would ask you to do that, and I'd ask you to do it quickly. Because you keep running that path, you're going to get hurt. Second person that might be here is a spiritual person where you're walking in the Spirit, but God's laid some people on your heart to pray for, to stand for, to check in on. You ought to do that this Christmas season. We need to be concerned about our brothers and sisters in Christ. We preach a lot about the unsaved world. People are hurting right beside us, bearing one another's burdens. A third person in the room, you don't know Jesus as your Savior. You need to come to faith in Christ today. You need to open your heart. Say, Lord Jesus, I believe upon you. Would you save me? Be my Lord and Savior. These are the three people. Which one are you? Every Sunday I give an altar call. The altar is here for prayer. Men and women are here to help. If you would like us to help you with one of those reasons, all you'd have to do is come forward and say, I'd like prayer, and we would pray with you. Would you stand, please? Heavenly Father, God, I sense you're moving, your sweet spirit in this place. Lord, people are checking their lives, analyzing where they are. Would you give courage to come and do business with you, and Lord, to get right with you, to be saved, and or maybe to be used of you to help in a restoration process with somebody, to pray for a brother and sister, to help bear one another's burdens. We need our church family. It's a lifting life than life which I now live. May it be true in our hearts. Have your way in this invitation, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen. Men of God, be here if you would, please. The altar is open. Our song is Take My Life and Let It Be. Brother Malcolm, come, lead us. You come as God leads you. If you need prayer, we'd love to help you. Lift your voice now, verse number one.
Take my life and let it be consecrated, Lord, to Thee. Take my moments and my days, let them flow in ceaseless praise. Let them flow in ceaseless praise. Take my hands and let them move at the impulse of Thy love. Take my feet and let them be swift and beautiful for Thee. Swift and beautiful for Thee. Take my voice and let me sing, always only for my King. Take my lips and let them be filled with messages for Thee. Filled with messages for Thee.
We'll do one more, but the Spirit of God wants me to say this to the person in the room that way back long time ago, you were overtaken in a fall and you were horribly mistreated by a pastor, by a church, by Christian people. You still bear the wound of that. It's kept you from certain things. All the devil will do is continue to work that and twist that until you give that to the Lord. Listen, man may have done that to you, but don't take what man has done in lieu of what the Lord Jesus has done. The Lord Jesus would never mistreat anybody. Right? So many people, if I could take you into my office and you could just hear the pain come out that happened inside some church building. What you need is you just need to run to the Lord and let the Lord heal you from that. Let the Lord give you grace from that. Not all churches are the same. Not all people are the same. This church loves this book. We love the God of this book, and we love people. Let's do one more. You just take it as it is.
Take my silver and my gold, not a mite would I withhold. Take my intellect and use every power as Thou shalt choose. Every power as Thou shalt choose.
Wonderful. Michaela, you want to get baptized? You know the Lord is your Savior?
Yes, sir.
No doubt about it. How old are you?
19.
You're joining the Marines.
Yes, sir.
19 and going to join the Marines. Wow. I'm afraid of her already. Been in our church how many years? Long time, haven't you? Grown up in the church. She knows God is her Savior. And she doesn't want to go to the Marine Corps without being right with God. And she believes God wants her to be baptized.
Amen.
I think we should rejoice over that and say amen, right? What a delight. What a joy. And I want you to come by and hug her neck and and shake her hand and tell her you'll be praying for her. I had two young men come to be baptized in the first service, so we got enough now. We're going to have a baptismal service and just rejoice. Not right this minute, but one of these days we'll have one. Tonight's going to be awesome. That's the only way I know to tell you about it. I hope you're here. If not, I'll see you on Wednesday night. When I first came to pastor here, every time we shook hands, we used to sing The Family of God. Do you remember that? And it just got old hat, so we changed it. But I can't think of a better song to sing to go home than I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. Lift your voice. Come by and shake Michaela's hand. Let's see you back tonight. God bless you.
I'm so glad I'm a part of the family of God. I've been washed in the fountain, cleansed by His blood, joined heirs with Jesus as we travel this side. For I'm part of the family, my family.